Author's Prefaces for Agamemnon. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by expatriate in Bangor, Maine. Agamemnon by Aeschylus. Translated by Edmund Doidge Anderson Morshead, 1849-1912. Author's Prefaces. First Preface. Aeschylus, son of Euphorion, an Athenian of the deme of Eleusis, was born B.C. 525. He consecrated his life to the tragic art from his youth upwards, yet he is held to have been a valiant soldier, and with his brother Kinegiris to have fought at Marathon and at Salamis and at Plataea, as some say. Afterwards, being at variance with the Athenians, he went away from them unto Sicily, and dwelt at the court of Hiero, tyrant of Gela, and was held by him in high honour. He died in his 69th year by a strange fate, whereof he had been warned in an oracle, saying, "A stroke from heaven shall slay thee." For as he was walking on the shore, an eagle that had snatched up a tortoise into the air let it drop, and it fell upon him, and he died. Such is almost all that we are told, and more than we can be said to know certainly of the life of the poet, whose masterpiece I have done my best to render into English verse, with the hope of helping one or two of those to whom the original is a closed book to share in its treasures. The remaining fragments of tradition, the cause of his quarrel with his countrymen, the statement that he divulged the sacred mysteries, remain not now to be verified. Of those given above, the tale of his death has been preserved for its striking singularity. It has the authority of story and no more. To his familiarity with war, by land and sea, his surviving dramas bear the strongest witness. There is a priori likelihood and intrinsic evidence, and some external testimony, of his having shared in one or more of the great battles which saved the Western world. Nor does his departure from Athens, to whatever cause it was due, nor his residence, apparently on two separate occasions in Sicily, admit of doubt. A vague statement that his poetry was inspired by wine, a portraiture of him by the pen of Aristophanes in The Frogs, intended, as I am convinced, those of Euripides and Socrates by the same hand were intended, mainly as a literary portrait of the author and teacher, not a delineation of the man as he was. Some notices from Aristotle of the improvements introduced by him into the arrangements of the dramatic stage. These, and a few others, form the whole of our scanty information respecting the life of Aeschylus, son of Euphorion. Stat magni nominis umbra. Of his works, there remain to us seven dramas only, out of a very large number. Fragments or notices bring up the total to 78 plays, of which the titles are known. If we can judge of those we have not in any degree, by those which we have, and many of the fragments lead us towards such an estimate, the chaos of lost things holds no equal treasure. But it is not now to be rescued. In his own words, in distois pelithontos utis alca. Perhaps a list of the surviving dramas may be useful to those wishing to form an idea of the poet's scope and range. These plays, in the chronological order that seems most probable, are 1. The Suppliant Maidens, the scene is laid at Argos. 2. The Prometheus Bound, the scene is on a Scythian peak, looking down from afar upon the Euxine. 3. The Persians, scene, the tomb of Darius at Susa, the treasure city of the king of Persia. 4. The Seven Against Thebes, scene, the city of Thebes in Boeotia. 5. The Agamemnon. 6. The Libation Bearers. And 7. The Furies. Of these three last plays, which form a consecutive whole called a trilogy, and yet are individually complete, the scene is Argos or Mycenae. Note: Argos and Mycenae are in reality about 6 miles apart, in the great Coilon Argos, wide valley of Argolis. The relics of the dynasty of Atreus are undoubtedly at Mycenae. Aeschylus, however, calls the scene always Argos, not caring to particularize about a district so well known. the fact that he describes the beacon fire on Mount Arachne as visible to the palace need not lead us to conclude that he had Argos more in mind than Mycenae, though the mountain is visible, if I remember right, from Larissa, the citadel of Argos, and not, I am sure, from the Acropolis of Mycenae. The beacon glare would have been clearly seen from either, no doubt. But Aeschylus ignores such detail. As Mr. Clark, Peloponnesus page 70, remarks, every Athenian saw daily from his own hills the peak of Arachne to the south, and knew it looked upon the region of Argos, and this was enough for the poet. Afterwards, the temple of Apollo at Delphi, lastly the Acropolis and Areopagus at Athens. Of an Athenian trilogy, that is a combination of three dramas by the same hand, whether on the same or different subjects, for consecutive presentment on the same day, and followed by a lighter play called a satyric drama, there remains to us this solitary specimen. Of the satyric drama, the Cyclops of Euripides, familiar to English readers by Shelley's translation. It may be added to explain the apparent difficulty of listening continuously to three dramas, each in itself a perfect whole, that in the first place a whole day of leisure, and not the last few hours between work or play and sleep of an exhausted audience, was devoted to the theatre, and secondly, that the whole length of the three plays combined, which form this trilogy, is rather less than that of Hamlet. I do not say that they would not necessarily take longer to act than Hamlet, but merely that the intellectual strain to an appreciative audience would not necessarily be greater. Change of interest, not mere rest, is the essential relaxation of the mind, and this, which Shakespeare provides, for example, by the soliloquies of Hamlet, the Greek dramatists, and preeminently Aeschylus, provided by the choric odes, or chants inserted between the several episodes of the play. Of such odes, this trilogy, and especially the Agamemnon, presents to us the noblest surviving specimens. They may be regarded as the poet's profoundest musings on the moral and religious and historical problems suggested by the mythical tale which forms the groundwork of his drama. Of the grandeur, the preternatural effect of these musings, while the imminent doom is preparing, no words of explanation or translation can give an adequate account. If it is lawful to adopt words written for a very different purpose by a poet in whom survives more of the spirit of Aeschylus than in any other modern, one might say of these choric odes, they are as a pause, a breathing space, a curtain behind which God, the great scene-shifter, prepares the last and supreme act of the mighty drama. Listen how, in the deep shadow behind, a dull and heavy sound is waxing. Listen, what footstep is that which passes to and fro? Look, how the curtain sways and waves and trembles before the breath of that which is behind. Note, Victor Hugo, Napoleon le Petit, last chapter. End note. Of the mythical tale, well known as it is, which forms the groundwork of this trilogy, some slight sketch may be useful. Atreus and Thyestes, sons of Pelops, fled from their father and dwelt at Argos with Eurystheus, the king thereof. And when he died, Atreus ruled in his place and wedded his daughter. But Thyestes wronged his brother's wife and was banished from Argos. And after a while he returned again and clung unto the altar at Argos. And Atreus, fearing to slay him, devised this deed. He slew certain of the children of Thyestes, and bade him to a banquet, and gave him to eat of his own children's flesh, and he ate, knowing not what it was. But when he knew what was done, he spake a bitter curse upon the house of Atreus, that they should all perish by a doom like that of his own children. And there befell these woes unto that house, that for three generations the curse of murder departed not away. For the children of Atreus, Agamemnon and Menelaus, wedded the daughters of Leda, Clytemnestra, and Helen. And afterwards Paris the son of Priam, being the guest of Menelaus, did bear away Helen his queen unto Troy. And Agamemnon and Menelaus went forth to vengeance against Paris and Troy. But Artemis was wroth with the brothers, and forbade their ships to sail. And they lay at Aulis many days. Then Calchas the prophet proclaimed that they should not go forth, unless Agamemnon should offer up his daughter Iphigenia in sacrifice unto Artemis. And the king was unwilling so to do. Yet for his oath's sake, and for his brother and the captains of the fleet, he consented and offered up his daughter, and the fleet sailed. And they besieged Troy for 9 years, and in the 10th year it fell. But Clytemnestra, the wife of Agamemnon, was wroth because of her daughter's death. And she did evil with Aegisthus, the youngest son of Thyestes. And they plotted to murder Agamemnon when he should return, and sent away his son Orestes unto Strophius, king of Phocis, that he might not know what they did. And when Agamemnon came back from Troy, Clytemnestra received him gladly, and led him into the palace. And as he was bathing himself, she flung over him a net, and smote him, and he died. And Clytemnestra and Aegisthus ruled in Argos. But Orestes heard of his father's wrongful death, and went unto the oracle of Delphi to inquire thereof, and Apollo bade him avenge his father, and not spare his own mother, but slay her. And secretly he came to Argos, bearing feigned news of his own death, in Phocis, and so came into the palace of his father again, and slew his mother Clytemnestra and Aegisthus. Then was he distraught and maddened by the Furies, in revenge for Clytemnestra's slaying. And he wandered over the earth, seeking purification for his deed, but the Furies followed him. At last he came to the temple of Delphi and clung to the altar. And the god cast a deep sleep over the Furies, and bade him fly to Athens, where he should find safety. But the ghost of Clytemnestra arose from the shades and awoke the Furies, and they followed him, and were wroth with Apollo. And they held dispute on the Acropolis, and Athena bade certain of the men of Athens decide the cause with her. And in the end they proclaimed the deed of Orestes to have been rightly done, and the guilt of matricide to have been wiped away. Then the Furies were angered with Athena and her land, but Athena promised them great honor from the Athenians, and a sacred dwelling place in the land, even a cave beneath Areopagus, and they were appeased, and were called no more Furies, but gracious goddesses. And Orestes went back unto his father's kingdom, and the curse of blood upon the house of Atreus was stayed. Note, I have ventured to give to the whole trilogy the title of the House of Atreus, as the name most applicable to all three parts. The older name Oresteia seems to me to have meant, in Aristophanes, the libation-bearers only. It is hardly applicable to the Agamemnon. It will be obvious, even from a compendium like the foregoing, that the myth is an epic in itself, and regarding Aeschylus' treatment of it as a whole, we may discern a special propriety in the poet's recorded saying that his dramas were scraps from the lordly feast of Homer. I have sometimes fancied that an interesting parallel might be drawn between the three parts of the trilogy and the three divisions of the Divine Comedy. For we have in both the same central idea, the succession, that is, of guilt, atonement, absolution. Dante fixes his epic in the future world, Aeschylus in the present. But mutatis mutandis, substituting the deepest religious thought of Athens for that of the Middle Ages, the most shadowy and gigantic vision of retributory forces for the clearest and most distinct. We shall find the parallel curiously suggestive, to say the least, of the essential unity of moral speculation. The first part of the trilogy, the drama Agamemnon, takes up the above myth at the point where Agamemnon's return from Troy is being anxiously awaited at Argos in the 10th year of the war. The first choric ode recalls some of the previous history, dwelling particularly on the circumstances of the sacrifice of Iphigenia. Then follows the appearance of the herald and of Agamemnon, the treacherous welcome of Clytemnestra, the prophecy of Cassandra, daughter of Priam, now a captive in Agamemnon's train, the murder of the king, and Clytemnestra's savage exultation over his body and that of Cassandra. With the appearance of Aegisthus and his avowal of his plot and motives, the drama closes, leaving Clytemnestra and her paramour in supreme power over Argos. The second part, called the Kephoroi, or libation-bearers, from the duty imposed upon the chorus of pouring libations on Agamemnon's tomb, opens with the secret return of Orestes, the mutual recognition of himself and his sister Electra, and their invocation of the sleepless spirit of their father to aid their planned revenge. Then Orestes, assuming the character of a Phocian stranger, recounts to Clytemnestra a feigned tale of his own death in that land. Then, received into the palace, he slays Aegisthus and Clytemnestra and avows his commission from Apollo to the deed. But already his are but wild and whirling words, and maddened by the guilt of blood he sees the Furies arise with dark robes and snaky hair, and calling on Apollo for protection, he flees wildly away. Note: two scenes of the trilogy have been thus admirably sketched by Mr. Browning in Pauline. Old lore loved for itself and all it shows, the king treading the purple calmly to his death, while round him like the clouds of eve all dusk, the giant shades of fate silently flitting, pile the dim outline of the coming doom. And the boy with his white breast and brow and clustering curls streaked with his mother's blood and striving hard to tell his story ere his reason goes. End note. The third part, called the Furies, the Greek name Eumenides, signifying literally the gracious goddesses, from the change in the nature of the Furies with which the drama closes, opens at Delphi in the temple of Apollo. The Furies lie in sleep, made drowsy by the god. Orestes clings to the altar. Apollo bids him be of good hope and depart unto Athens while the Furies are yet asleep. As he passes from the stage, the ghost of Clytemnestra rises and calls the slumbering Furies to arise and pursue the criminal. Then Apollo himself, with words of loathing, bids them forth from his temple, and scenting like hounds the track of blood, they follow the flying Orestes. Here the scene shifts to Athens. Orestes, having followed the behest of Apollo, clings to the statue of Athena on the Acropolis and claims her aid. The cause is tried, apparently on Areopagus, the scene probably representing both the Acropolis and the adjacent Areopagus, Athena presiding, Apollo pleading Orestes' part, the Furies impeaching him of matricide. The votes are cast and found equal for acquittal and condemnation, and this result, as Athena has previously ruled, gives Orestes the benefit of the doubt. The Furies, wroth at being thus defrauded of their victim, vow vengeance on Athena's land and nation. But she appeases them by promising them honorable worship forever, as gracious and fostering powers of earth from her own Athenians. And so, solemnly escorted by torches and processions, they pass down into their subterranean cave beneath Areopagus, with words of blessing upon Attica. And the third and last part of the trilogy closes with joy and with extinction of the curse. It will appear by a glance at this plot that the Agamemnon and the Libation Bearers are both of them tragedies in the accepted modern sense, the one closing with the death of Agamemnon and the triumph of murder and adultery, the other with the death of Clytemnestra and with madness as the reward of matricide. The Furies might seem, to modern eyes, less a tragedy than a drama of restoration, yet it conforms in all respects to the Aristotelian definition of tragedy. The situation is undeniably tragic, though the conclusion dispels the gloom. The trilogy is Aeschylus's presentment of two problems, each of eternal import, though the form in which he contemplated them was the common theme of the Greek drama. These problems are, 1, the retribution of crime, 2, the inheritance or transmission of evil. The views of the poet on each may perhaps be illustrated by a few excerpts from his writings. It has been pointed out, Plumptree Biographical Essay, that in many cases they are reflections on the nomai, or current proverbs of the day, the foundations of Greek philosophy, but often as forgotten as those who laid them. Sometimes the poet actually quotes and acknowledges the proverb as a trigeron muthos, an immemorial saying, but often it is probable that some piece of apparently irrelevant mysticism is in reality the poet's reflection on some saying familiar to his audience, but not recognizable by us. Such, for example, I believe to be the case in the celebrated passage in Agamemnon 160, Zeus, ostis potestin. Retribution. Among the dead, this bitter name of murderous clings ever to my soul. I wander, scorned of all. Though he go down to the grave, the guilty is never freed. The sinner on whose hand is a stain of blood must see the Furies rise at his side, avengers of murder, champions of the slain. The Furies, lines 175 and 316. There is one who spoils the spoiler. The slayer in his turn is slain. While Zeus is lord of the world, it is fixed that all who sin shall suffer. Agamemnon, line 1562. The anvil block of justice is planted firm. Fate the swordsmith hammers the steel of her design. The mighty Fury from her dark depth of counsel requites to the uttermost at last the guilt of blood shed forth of old. The libation bearers, line 647. There is a law that blood drops shed upon the ground demand other bloodshed in requital. Murder calls aloud, summoning a Fury, who brings a further woe, sent up in vengeance from those who were slain before. The libation bearers, line 400. Inheritance of evil. One said of old that the gods have no heed to punish him who tramples down the grace of things holy. 'Twas impiously said. Their vengeance is manifested upon the children of all who breathe forth rebellion over much, what time their houses teem with weal too great for man. Agamemnon, line 369. There is an ancient saying that human bliss, if it reach its summit, doth not die childless, that from prosperity springs up a bane, a woe insatiable. I hold not so. 'Tis impious act that bears those many children, all like the race from which they sprang. But the house of the upright hath a blessed fate, a progeny of good. Agamemnon, line 750. These excerpts, few out of many passages bearing on the same subject, may perhaps be a help towards grasping the import of these dramas as a whole. Not the least of Aeschylus's claims to honor is his divergence in some points from the traditional and accepted views of the time with respect to hereditary guilt and responsibility. A belief in a jealous and vindictive power, in children suffering for their father's sins, in families lying under a curse for generations, was not only familiar to the Athenians of this epoch, but approached the condition of an accepted tenet. It was even at times a political force, as, in the case of Pericles, his membership of the Alcmaeonid family, which lay under a curse for the perfidious and impious murder of the partisans of Cylon, undoubtedly operated in his disfavor. See Thucydides, Book 1, Chapter 127. The proportion of people who believe in an unjust, capricious, and vindictive god may have diminished since the time of Aeschylus and Ezekiel. Yet to this day, so large a minority are haunted by corresponding ideas, so considerable even in our own time has been the political influence of such notions, that the earnest protest of the Hebrew prophet and the less distinct yet equally purified doctrine of the Athenian poet can neither of them be said to have lost their importance nor to have done their work. The 18th chapter of Ezekiel and the 3rd chorus of the Agamemnon should be read together as the grandest assertions in pre-Christian times of the justice of God. The poetry of Aeschylus is the precursor of the philosophy of Plato. The vague and mysterious problems over which the poet brooded became the subjects of moral philosophy in the next generation. Let it be remembered that we have in Aeschylus the beginnings of speculation, not its ultimate forms, and the greatness of this first step will be at once apparent. Aeschylus deals especially with two popular theories, one, the doctrine of the jealousy of heaven against human prosperity as such, and two, the doctrine above mentioned of the inheritance of evil in certain families. The first he may be said to deny. The teaching of Solon, as recorded and exemplified by Herodotus in the History of Croesus, Book 1, Chapters 30 through 33, that the divine power is altogether jealous and loves to trouble the estate of man, is confronted by Aeschylus with the assertion of justice, not caprice, as ruling over man. That this conception brought the poet into collision with the popular ideas of Zeus is manifest from the drama of Prometheus Vinctus, where, unfortunately, we have the problem without its solution, the rest of the trilogy being lost. That the national polytheism had little hold on his belief however largely it affected his poetry, seems to me plain from all his deeper utterances, notwithstanding the assertion of Clausen to the contrary. But of the poet's attitude towards the theory of a vindictive god, there is no question. "I am alone in my thought," he cries. "It is not wealth nor prosperity. It is impiety that breeds other sins, and woe for its sequel. It is hard to resist the temptations of wealth and power and victory. Yet not these things, but the yielding to their temptations, do the gods punish. Not Agamemnon's triumph, not even the carnage of Troy, but his arrogance and pride on his return, his making himself equal to the gods." The second doctrine, that of the inheritance of evil in certain families, forms the groundwork of the whole trilogy, and the poet's views on it must be collected. They are nowhere concentrated or distinctly expressed. Substantially, they appear to apply to the following condition of things. The idea of an ate, or inherited curse, which dogs certain families, has a double origin. 1. An origin of fact. The children are like their parents, grow up under their influence, borrow from their connection with them much of their own character. 2. An origin in custom. A family crime had a far more serious import to an ancient Greek than we can readily realize. It is the simple fact that the idea of individual responsibility and even of individual existence was almost absent from him. The family was his unit. The family sinned in the sin of any of its members. The family exacted or suffered vengeance. Any member of the family who was slain by another was held to have incurred the stain of suicide. The author of the trilogy endeavors to purify these ideas and to reconcile them alike with the doctrine of justice and with the facts of the world. The reality of the curse is not denied, but the voluntary nature of each stage in its history is asserted, as is the responsibility of the individual criminal for his own act. The temptation, the predisposition, may be extraneous, may be imposed by heaven. The deed is his own. The first step he is master not to take. But if once it be taken, if the altar of right be once spurned, the miserable, desperate impulse is upon him. He goes from sin to sin. There is no help for him. He has passed among the lost. Such, I believe, is the inner doctrine of Aeschylus, struggling to light through language of vague import and occasional inconsistencies, especially in the relation of this process of evil to the divine will or permission. Nor must we forget his solution of the moral problem in the Furies. The family guilt and curse are to be closed by an appeal to human justice, which measures the guilt of the individual by the circumstances and motives of his crime, and has power to absolve as well as to mete out punishment to an admitted criminal. Granting, as we must grant, the belief in such an hereditary curse as Aeschylus made the subject of his trilogy, it is impossible to conceive a nobler solution of the problem, a nobler purification by pity and terror, if we may adopt in an extended sense Aristotle's definition of tragedy. Perhaps it may not be out of place to say a few words with respect to a charge often brought against Aeschylus of being a bombastic poet. It is undeniable that in his earlier plays there is a tendency towards inflated language. Such prodigies as Ephipsalosi Kadzebrotithi Sthenon, from Prometheus, line 362, as Alosimon Paian Ebedziakathas, 7 against Thebes, line 635, show at all events a poetic artist who has not yet fully dissevered the large from the fine, the grandiose from the grand. Neither are the thoughts in these plays always free from the same charge, though the occurrence of metaphors which we regard as oriental seems to me to demonstrate capacity rather than extravagance in the Greek poet. It is surprising, for instance, to find in the celebrated description of the Battle of Salamis, the Persians, line 577, and of the floating corpses of the drowned Persians and death gnawing upon them, Skulontai pros anaudon paidon tas amiantu. They are scattered and peeled by the voiceless children of the pure, that is, the sea. It is surprising, I say, to find such a phrase treated as fantastic and oriental. The same thought has been touched by Shakespeare in The Tempest, Act 2, Scene 1. O thou, mine heir of Naples and of Milan, what strange fish hath made his meal on thee? And by Shelley, in similes, as a shark and dogfish wait under an Atlantic isle for the negro ship whose freight is the theme of their debate, wrinkling their red gills the while. But how inferior each expression is to that of Aeschylus need hardly be pointed out. Shakespeare's is simple almost to baldness, Shelley's powerfully, almost horribly descriptive. But Aeschylus, retaining the physical world, skulontai, paints the rest of the scene with a rich imagination. The children of earth, but now so clamorous, are at the mercy of the still children of that sea, whose translucent purity they have harassed and distracted in vain. However this may be, what I wish to point out is that all traces of immature work have disappeared when we reach the trilogy. The sonorous verse remains, but the exaggerated style is gone. The ponderous imprecations of the Prometheus or the Seven Against Thebes have turned to verse like this. Matin teleon tis emis paidas dikin atin erinanth aisi tono esphads ego umoi phobu melathron elpis empatein. Occasionally, as in the prophecy of Calchas, the oracular style is purposely assumed, or, as in the Furies, line 285 and following, a scene of monstrous horrors is described in monstrous terms. But of real bombast, of large language misapplied, there is no more. With this disappearance, a new faculty has arisen, a dramatic art of the most admirable kind. Not even the excellent double interest of the Oedipus Tyrannus of Sophocles is superior to the scene of Clytemnestra's welcome of Agamemnon, with its effusive insincerity and ominous words of double and deadly meaning. The whole character of Clytemnestra is a refutation of those who maintain that we may find poetry in Aeschylus, but must go to Sophocles or Euripides for drama. Nor must we omit to notice the marvelous art displayed in the whole episode of Cassandra. Her spirit is utterly full of Apollo, the sun god, the slayer of night. A mention, nay, a mere hint of him, Puthakranta, line 1255, banishes in a moment her brief sanity, and she bursts into ravings again. She is penetrated with the fire intolerant and intense of his coming, of the sunrise of prophecy burning brighter and clearer, while in its light the great waves of doom roll up and on. His approach is a scorching glow of fire before his presence is revealed. Papai, oion topur epergetai demoi, ototoi auke apollon. Ah, ah, the fire, it waxes nears me now. Woe, woe for me, Apollo of the dawn. And her last speech is a cry to the actual sun, whose light she will see no more forever, to light her avengers to their work. Close inspection of all this scene will show Aeschylus at his very highest point of inspiration. It is as true and as imaginative as anything in King Lear. With respect to the text, I think I have only once departed from usual interpretations. Where the text is mutilated or corrupt, I have supplied or amended, as the context seemed to direct, to the extent of a word or two. See appendix to the Libation Bearers. The one occasion where my version differs, I believe, from any yet suggested, is the celebrated passage from Agamemnon, lines 105 and 7. Etigar theothen katapneai petho myopan alka sumphutas ion. This I have interpreted in opposition to those who have taken alka sumphutas ion as in some way describing the condition of the speaker. I suggest that it may rather be taken closely with Theothen, and that the whole passage means, still upon me doth the divine life, whose strength waxes never old, literally, which is congenital with strength, breathe from heaven the impulse of song. This seems to suit the context well, as I may shortly explain. The chorus have just been bewailing the sad and tremulous weakness of old age, too feeble for war, too feeble to walk without a staff, sad and presageful of future evils, and only at moments roused to hope by propitious omens of sacrifice. Suddenly the light of comfort breaks upon them. Old and feeble, they have yet the divine inspiration of song, breathed on them from realms of help, alka, by powers which never wax old nor feeble. Then follows the matchless ode with its profound theology, its analysis of human perplexity, its utter pathos in describing the sacrifice of Iphigenia. In defense of this view, I would urge that alka is not a usual word. At least I have been unable to find an instance of its use for any mental power like genius or inspiration. It almost always means physical prowess, and if it becomes metaphorical at all, it becomes so in the sense of help or aid, as in the Furies, line 257, alkan echon, clasping or holding help by embracing the image of the goddess, taking sanctuary in short. If this view of the word be correct, the word itself applies very ill to the chorus, whose physical feebleness and powerlessness to help have just been alluded to, but very well to the gods, whose ageless strength and power to aid are contrasted with human weakness. The thought is alka sumphutas ion will thus be parallel to that in agiro chrono dunastas of Sophocles in Antigone, line 608. Undoubtedly there is a difficulty in applying such a phrase as sumphutas ion to the divine life at all. But it seems allowable to use words properly only applicable to human life with reference to the divine in a passage like this, where in thought the contrast is drawn between the former as an ion sumphutas indeed, but not alka sumphutas, and the latter, verily an ion in the wider sense, an alka sumphutas, coeval with its eternal power to prompt and aid. And certainly the word katapneia in its most literal sense seems to suit this idea of a sacred impulse, an aid like a wafting wind breathed down from heaven. I put forward this conjecture without confidence, and merely as one more endeavor to elucidate a passage of more than usual interest, which is allowed to be dubious hitherto. To make it refer to the life or condition of the speaker seems to me difficult. To translate it the time coextensive with the war, almost impossible. Whether my own conjecture is any better, judicen alii. For the feeling of the whole passage, it might not be amiss to compare Goethe's vindication of the honor and toil that await the old in song. Doch ins bekannte Seitenspiel mit Mut in Anmut einzugreifen, nach einem selbst gesteckten Ziel, mit holdem Ehren hinzuschweifen, das alte Herrn ist eure Pflicht. Faust Part 1, Theatre Prelude. With respect to the translation, my object has been throughout to be, if possible, readable. I have sacrificed much that scholars might fairly desiderate, reproduction of the original meters, preservation of strophe and antistrophe, and so forth, on this ground, that I found my own metrical skill insufficient to satisfy even myself in such a task. I have little doubt that certain parts, Cassandra's earlier ravings, for instance, or the wrath of the Furies, would be most fitly rendered in prose, like that of the analogous passages of King Lear and Macbeth. But here, too, after a struggle, I resign the conflict. It is easy to write prose. It is impossible to write that prose. The anapestic systems have been mostly rendered in octosyllabic meter. Where dactylic feet were predominant in the original, I have sometimes adopted the heroic quatrain, sometimes loose and irregular, but always rhyming measures. The earlier part of the third chorus of the Agamemnon I have endeavored to reproduce in that arrangement of octosyllabic verses used with such admirable effect by Mr. Swinburne in the prologue and epilogue of Songs Before Sunrise. The iambic dialogue has been rendered into such blank verse or rhyming couplets as I could command, the trochaic passages into rhyming verse of greater length. Any coincidences that may be found between other translations and the present may claim to be for the most part accidental. Whatever has been consciously adopted from elsewhere has been acknowledged in a footnote, unless so familiar as to have become common property. Thus I have not thought it necessary to avow obvious obligations to Shakespeare, nor to ascribe the airy rings of the vulture's flight in the first chorus of the Agamemnon to Jonson, nor the sleep of swords, that fine rendering of the Homeric Calchaeus Upnos, to Kingsley, nor the rhythm of one choric passage in the Libation Bearers to W. Morris. Such things are public property now. Part of this translation, that is, the Agamemnon, having been already published, I have had for that part the advantage of public criticism. I have carefully considered all such criticism, so far as it has reached me, and have removed, I hope, all positive errors that have been detected. Those critics who have complained rather of the general faults of the translation, such, for example, as diffuseness or a modern tone, than of particular errors, will, I hope, believe my assurance that their words have been duly weighed. If I have not recast the translation to the extent their criticism demanded, it is neither from doubting its substantial truth nor the seriousness of the fault. But I am not sanguine, after various attempts, of my being able to translate in a closer and more pregnant style. It is not a question of how the thing could be done best in the abstract. It is, unfortunately, the more limited and painful question how a particular individual can do it least imperfectly. My main obligations in the matter of Aeschylus are expressed in the dedication. In addition, I am indebted to the Reverend W. A. Fearon, Assistant Master of Winchester, for revising a large part of the Agamemnon, to Mr. C. Keegan Paul for useful criticisms, mainly though not wholly on the same play, to Mr. A. O. Prickard, Fellow and Lecturer of New College, Oxford, for incidental assistance throughout the work, particularly in the Libation Bearers and the Furies, to Mr. C. B. Phillips, Assistant Master of Winchester, who has gone over the whole translation with care, to Mr. D. S. Margoliath, Fellow of New College, Oxford, who has helped me especially with several difficulties in the Furies. Other friends will, I doubt not, accept the general acknowledgement of their aid. I cannot, however, leave unspecified my gratitude to Mr. F. R. Benson and the rest of the Oxford Company, who last year performed the Agamemnon on the stage, for the practical insight they afforded their audience into the spectacular as well as the literary and dramatic merit of that noblest of poems. E.D.A.M. Winchester, March 1881. Preface to the Second Edition. In republishing The House of Atreus, I have striven to remove the flaws to which private or public criticism called my attention. A grave mistranslation of the Furies, line 216, has, I hope, been banished. Mr. A. O. Prickard and Professor Margoliath independently detected and denounced it to me. I now plead with Orestes, Miasma, Dek Pluton, Pele, Kronos, Kathaire, Panta, Giraskon, Omu. I may be permitted to add a statement of the general principle that I have followed in making alterations. Errors in scholarship I have endeavored to remove. Where the English has been criticized, I have always considered and often obeyed the criticism. Sometimes I have resisted it in obedience to a higher law. For example, several critics objected to the use of the word spilth. I have retained it as used by Shakespeare and therefore fitted for tragic poetry, though no longer in ordinary use. With regard to the form of the translation, I had not made any serious change. Were I now attempting the thing for the first time, I should not throw so much of the first chorus of the Agamemnon into quatrains. But in this, as in other cases, that which was originally difficult to do has become almost impossible to undo and do again. The previous translation stands like an erring and prohibitory ghost. Micet aselfis tade phonon. E.D.A.M. Winchester, October 1899. End of author's prefaces. Recording by expatriate in Bangor, Maine. Part 1 of Agamemnon by Aeschylus, translated by Edmund Doidge Anderson Morshead, 1849-1912. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by expatriate in Bangor, Maine. Part 1. Dramatis Personae, a Watchman, Chorus, Clytemnestra, a Herald, Agamemnon, Cassandra, Aegisthus. The scene is the palace of Atreus at Mycenae. In front of the palace stand statues of the gods and altars prepared for sacrifices. A Watchman. I pray the gods to quit me of my toils, to close the watch I keep this livelong year. For as a watchdog lying not at rest, propped on one arm, upon the palace roof of Atreus' race, too long, too well I know the starry conclave of the midnight sky, too well the splendors of the firmament, the lords of light whose kingly aspect shows, what time they set or climb the sky in turn, the year's divisions bringing frost or fire. And now as ever am I set to mark when shall stream up the glow of signal flame, the bale fire bright, and tell its Trojan tale, Troy town is ta'en, such issue holds in hope, she in whose woman's breast beats heart of man. Thus upon mine unrestful couch I lie, bathed with the dews of night, unvisited by dreams. Ah me, for in the place of sleep stands fear as my familiar, and repels the soft repose that would mine eyelids seal. And if at whiles, for the lost balm of sleep, I medicine my soul with melody of trill or song, anon to tears I turn, wailing the woe that broods upon this home, not now by honour guided as of old. But now at last, fair fall the welcome hour that sets me free, whene'er the thick night glow with beacon fire of hope deferred no more. All hail! A beacon light is seen reddening the distant sky. Fire of the night that brings my spirit day, shedding on Argos light and dance and song, greetings to fortune, hail! Let my loud summons ring within the ears of Agamemnon's queen, that she anon start from her couch, and with a shrill voice cry a joyous welcome to the beacon blaze, for Ilion's fall. Such fiery message gleams from yon high flame, and I before the rest will foot the lightsome measure of our joy, for I can say, my master's dice fell fair, behold, the triple syce, the lucky flame. Now be my lot to clasp in loyal love the hand of him restored who rules our home. Home, but I say no more, upon my tongue treads hard the ox of the adage. Had it voice, the home itself might soothliest tell its tale. I, of set will, speak words the wise may learn, to others naught remember nor discern. Exit. The chorus of old men of Mycenae enter, each leaning on a staff. During their song, Clytemnestra appears in the background, kindling the altars. Chorus. 10 livelong years have rolled away since the twin lords of sceptered sway, by Zeus endowed with pride of place, the doughty chiefs of Atreus' race went forth of yore, to plead with Priam face to face before the judgment seat of war. 1,000 ships from Argive land put forth to bear the martial band, that with a spirit stern and strong went out to right the kingdom's wrong, pealed as they went the battle song, wild as the vulture's cry, when o'er the eyrie soaring high in wild bereaved agony, around, around in airy rings, they wheel with orage of their wings, but not the Aeus brood behold that called them to the nest of old. But let Apollo from the sky, or Pan or Zeus, but hear the cry, the exile cry, the wail forlorn, of birds from whom their home is torn. On those who wrought the rapine fell, heaven sends the vengeful fiends of hell. Even so doth Zeus, the jealous lord and guardian of the hearth and board, speed Atreus' sons in vengeful ire against Paris, sends them forth on fire, her to buy back in war and blood, whom one did wed, but many wooed. And many, many by his will, the last embrace of foes shall feel, and many a knee in dust be bowed, and splintered spears on shields ring loud of Trojan and of Greek, before that iron bridal feast be o'er. But as he willed, 'tis ordered all, and woes by heaven ordained must fall, unsoothed by tears or spilth of wine poured forth too late, the wrath divine glares vengeance on the flameless shrine. And we in grey dishonoured eld, feeble of frame, unfit were held to join the warrior array that then went forth unto the fray. And here at home we tarry, fain our feeble footsteps to sustain, each on his staff, so strength doth wane, and turns to childishness again. For while the sap of youth is green, and yet unripened leaps within, the young are weakly as the old, and each alike unmeet to hold the vantage post of war. And ah, when flower and fruit are o'er, and on life's tree the leaves are sere, Age wendeth propped its journey drear, as forceless as a child, as light and fleeting as a dream of night lost in the garish day. But thou, O child of Tyndareus, Queen Clytemnestra, speak, and say what messenger of joy today hath won thine ear, what welcome news that thus in sacrificial wise e'en to the city's boundaries thou biddest altar fires arise. Each god who doth our city guard and keeps o'er Argos watch and ward, from heaven above, from earth below, the mighty lords who rule the skies, the market's lesser deities, to each and all the altars glow, piled for the sacrifice. And here and there, anear, afar, streams skyward many a beacon star, conjured and charmed and kindled well by pure oil's soft and guileless spell, hid now no more within the palace secret store. O queen, we pray thee, whatsoe'er known unto thee were well revealed, that thou wilt trust it to our ear and bid our anxious heart be healed, that waneth now unto despair, now, waxing to a presage fair, dawns from the altar hope, to scare from our rent hearts the vulture care. List, for the power is mine, to chant on high the chief's emprise, the strength that omens gave. List, on my soul breathes yet a harmony from realms of ageless powers and strong to save. How brother kings, twin lords of one command, led forth a youth of Hellas in their flower, urged on their way with vengeful spear and brand by warrior birds that watched the parting hour. Go forth to Troy, the eagles seemed to cry, and the sea kings obeyed the sky king's word, when on the right they soared across the sky, and one was black, one bore a white tail barred. High o'er the palace were they seen to soar, then lit in sight of all in rent and tear, far from the fields that they should range no more, big with her unborn brood a mother hare. And one beheld the soldier prophet true, and the two chiefs unlike of soul and will, in the twy-colored eagles straight he knew, and spake the omen forth for good and ill. Ah, woe, and well a day, but be the issue fair. Go forth, he cried, and Priam's town shall fall. Yet long the time shall be, and flock and herd, the people's wealth that roam before the wall, shall force hew down, when fate shall give the word. But oh, beware, lest wrath in heaven abide, to dim the glowing battle forge once more, and mar the mighty curb of Trojan pride, the steel of vengeance, welded as for war. For virgin Artemis bears jealous hate against the royal house, the eagle pair, who rend the unborn brood insatiate, yea, loathes their banquet on the quivering hair. Ah, woe and well a day, but be the issue fair, for well she loves the goddess kind and mild, the tender newborn cubs of lions bold, too weak to range, and well the sucking child of every beast that roams by wood and wold. So to the Lord of Heaven she prayeth still, nay, if it must be the omen true, yet do the visioned eagles presage ill, the end be well, but crossed with evil too. Healer Apollo, be her wrath controlled, nor weave the long delay of thwarting gales to war against the Danaans, and withhold from the free ocean waves their eager sails. She craves, alas, to see a second life shed forth, a cursed unhallowed sacrifice, twixt wedded souls artificer of strife, and hate that knows not fear and fell device. At home there tarries like a lurking snake, biding its time a wrath unreconciled, a wily watcher passionate to slake in blood resentment for a murdered child. Such was the mighty warning, pealed of yore, amid good tidings such the word of fear, what time the fateful eagles hovered o'er the kings, and Calchas read the omen clear. And leave the league of ships, and fail each true ally, for rightfully they crave with eager fiery mind the virgin's blood shed forth to lull the adverse wind. God send the deed be well. Thus on his neck he took fate's hard compelling yoke, then in the counter gale of will abhorred accursed, to recklessness his shifting spirit veered. Alas, that frenzy first of ills and worst, with evil craft men's souls to sin hath ever stirred. And so he steeled his heart, ah, well a day, aiding a war for one false woman's sake, his child to slay, and with her spilt blood make an offering to speed the ships upon their way. Lusting for war, the bloody arbiters closed heart and ears, and would nor hear nor heed the girl voice plead, "Pity me, father," nor her prayers, nor tender virgin years. So when the chant of sacrifice was done, her father bade the youthful priestly train raise her, like some poor kid, above the altar stone, from where amid her robes she lay, sunk all in swoon away. Bade them as with the bit that mutely tames the steed, her fair-lipped speech refrain, lest she should speak a curse on Atreus' home and seed, so trailing on the earth her robe of saffron dye, with one last piteous dart from her beseeching eye, those that should smite she smote, fair silent as a pictured form, but fain to plead, is all forgot? How oft those halls of old, wherein my sire high feast did hold, rang to the virginal soft strain, when I a stainless child sang from pure lips and undefiled, sang of my sire and all his honored life, and how on him should fall heaven's highest gift and gain. And then, but I beheld not nor can tell what further fate befell, but this is sure, that Calchas' boding strain can ne'er be void or vain. This wage from justice' hand do sufferers earn, the future to discern. And yet, farewell, O secret of tomorrow, foreknowledge is for sorrow. Clear with the clear beams of the morrow's sun the future presseth on. Now, let the house's tale, how dark soe'er, find yet an issue fair. So praise the loyal solitary band that guards the Apian land. They turn to Clytemnestra, who leaves the altars and comes forward. O queen, I come in reverence of thy sway, for while the ruler's kingly seat is void, the loyal heart before his consort bends. Now, be it sure and certain news of good, or the fair tidings of a flattering hope, that bids thee spread the light from shrine to shrine, I, fain to hear, yet grudge not if thou hide. Clytemnestra. As saith the adage, from the womb of night spring forth with promise fair the young child light. I fairer even than all hope my news, by Grecian hands is Priam's city ta'en. Chorus. What sayest thou? Doubtful heart makes treacherous ear. Clytemnestra. Hear then again and plainly, Troy is ours. Chorus. Thrills through my heart such joy as wakens tears. Clytemnestra. Aye, through those tears, thine eye looks loyalty. Chorus. But hast thou proof to make assurance sure? Clytemnestra. Go to, I have, unless the god has lied. Chorus. Hath some night vision won thee to belief? Clytemnestra. Out on all presage of a slumbrous soul. Chorus. But wert thou cheered by rumor's wingless word? Clytemnestra. Peace. Thou dost chide me as a credulous girl. Chorus. Say then, how long ago the city fell? Clytemnestra. Even in this night that now brings forth the dawn. Chorus. Yet who so swift could speed the message here? Clytemnestra. From Ida's top Hephaestus, lord of fire, sent forth his sign, and on and ever on, beacon to beacon sped the courier flame, from Ida to the crag that Hermes loves of Lemnos, thence unto the steep sublime of Athos, throne of Zeus, the broad blaze flared, thence raised aloft to shoot across the sea, the moving light rejoicing in its strength, sped from the pyre of pine and urged its way in golden glory like some strange new sun, onward, and reached Mecistus' watching heights. There, with no dull delay nor heedless sleep, the watcher sped the tidings on in turn, until the guard upon Messapius' peak saw the fair flame gleam on Europa's tide, and from the high-piled heap of withered firs lit the new sign and bade the message on. Then the strong light, far-flown and yet undimmed, shot through the sky above Asopus' plain, bright as the moon, and on Kithaeron's crag aroused another watch of flying fire. And there the sentinels no whit disowned, but sent redoubled on the hest of flame. Swift shot the light above Gorgopis Bay, to Aegiplanctus' mount, and bade the peak fail not the onward ordinance of fire. and like a long beard streaming in the wind, full fed with fuel, roared and rose the blaze, and onward flaring gleamed above the cape, beneath which shimmers the Saronic bay. And thence leapt light unto Arachne's peak, the mountain watch that looks upon our town, thence to the Atreides' roof, in lineage fair, a bright posterity of Ida's fire. So sped from stage to stage, fulfilled in turn, flame after flame, along the course ordained, and lo, the last to speed upon its way sights the end first, and glows unto the goal. And Troy is ta'en, and by this sign my lord tells me the tale, and ye have learned my word. Chorus. To heaven, O queen, will I upraise new song, but wouldst thou speak once more, I fain would hear from first to last the marvel of the tale. Clytemnestra. Think you, this very morn the Greeks in Troy, and loud therein the voice of utter wail, within one cup pour vinegar and oil, and look, unblent, unreconciled they war. So in the twofold issue of the strife mingle the victor's shout, the captive's moan. For all the conquered whom the sword has spared cling weeping, some unto a brother slain, some childlike to a nursing father's form, and wail the loved and lost, the while their neck bows down already neath the captive's chain. And lo, the victors, now the fight is done, goaded by restless hunger, far and wide range, all disordered through the town, to snatch such victual and such rest as chance may give within the captive halls that once were Troy. Joyful to rid them of the frost and dew, wherein they couched upon the plain of old, joyful to sleep the gracious night all through, unsummoned of the watching sentinel. Yet let them reverence well the city's gods, the lords of Troy, though fallen, and her shrines. So shall the spoilers not in turn be spoiled. Yea, let no craving for forbidden gain bid conquerors yield before the darts of greed. For we need yet, before the race be won, homewards unharmed to round the course once more. For should the host wax wanton ere it come, then though the sudden blow of fate be spared, yet in the sight of gods shall rise once more the great wrong of the slain to claim revenge. Now hearing from this woman's mouth of mine the tale and eke its warning, pray with me, luck sway the scale with no uncertain poise, for my fair hopes are changed to fairer joys. Chorus. A gracious word thy woman's lips have told, worthy a wise man's utterance, O my queen. Now with clear trust in thy convincing tale, I set me to salute the gods with song, who bring us bliss to counterpoise our pain. Exit Clytemnestra. Zeus, lord of heaven, and welcome knight of victory that hast our might with all the glories crowned, on towers of Ilion, free no more, hast flung the mighty mesh of war and closely girt them round, till neither warrior may scape nor stripling lightly overleap the trammels as they close and close, till with a grip of doom our foes in slavery's coil are bound. Zeus, lord of hospitality, in grateful awe I bend to thee, 'tis thou hast struck the blow. At Alexander long ago we marked thee bend thy vengeful bow, but long and warily withhold the eager shaft, which uncontrolled and loosed too soon or launched too high, had wandered bloodless through the sky. Zeus, the high god, whate'er be dim in doubt, this can our thought track out. The blow that fells the sinner is of God, and as he wills the rod of vengeance smiteth sore. One said of old, the gods list not to hold a reckoning with him whose feet oppress the grace of holiness. An impious word, for whensoe'er the sire breathed forth rebellious fire, what time his household overflowed the measure of bliss and health and treasure, his children's children read the reckoning plain, at last in tears and pain. On me let weal that brings no woe be sent, and therewith all content. Who spurns the shrine of right, nor wealth nor power, shall be to him a tower, to guard him from the gulf. There lies his lot, where all things are forgot. Lust drives him on, lust desperate and wild, fate's sin-contriving child, and cure is none. Beyond concealment clear, kindles sin's baleful glare. as an ill coin beneath the wearing touch betrays by stain and smutch its metal false, such is the sinful wight. Before on pinions light fair pleasure flits and lures him childlike on, while home and kin make moan beneath the grinding burden of his crime, till in the end of time, cast down of heaven, he pours forth fruitless prayer to powers that will not hear. And such did Paris come unto Atreides' home, and thence with sin and shame his welcome to repay, ravish the wife away. And she, unto her country and her kin, leaving the clash of shields and spears and arming ships, and bearing unto Troy destruction for a dower, and overbold in sin, went fleetly through the gates at midnight hour. Oft from the prophet's lips moaned out the warning and the wail, ah, woe! Woe for the home, and for the chieftains, woe! Woe for the bride-bed, warm yet from the lovely limbs, the impress of the form of her who loved her lord a while ago! And woe for him who stands, shamed, silent, unreproachful, stretching hands that find her not, and sees, yet will not see, that she is far away. And his sad fancy, yearning o'er the sea, shall summon and recall her wraith once more to queen it in his hall. And sad with many memories, the fair cold beauty of each sculptured face, and all to hatefulness is turned her grace, seen blankly by forlorn and hungering eyes. And when the night is deep, come visions sweet and sad, and bearing pain of hoping's vain, void, void, and vain, for scarce the sleeping sight has seen its old delight, when through the grasps of love that bid it stay, it vanishes away, on silent wings that roam adown the ways of sleep. Such are the sights the sorrows fell above our hearth, and worse whereof I may not tell, but all the wide town o'er, each home that sent its master far away from Hellas' shore, feels the keen thrill of heart, the pang of loss today. For truth to say, the touch of bitter death is manifold. Familiar was each face, and dear as life, that went unto the war. But thither whence a warrior went of old doth not return, only a spear and sword, and ashes in an urn. For Ares, lord of strife, who doth the swaying scales of battle hold, war's money-changer giving dust for gold, sends back to hearts that held them dear scant ash of warriors wept with many a tear, light to the hand but heavy to the soul, yea, fills the light urn full with what survived the flame, death's dusty measure of a hero's frame. Alas, one cries, and yet alas again, our chief is gone, the hero of the spear, and hath not left his peer. Ah, woe, another moans, my spouse is slain, the death of honour rolled in dust and blood, slain for a woman's sin, a false wife's shame. Such muttered words of bitter mood rise against those who went forth to reclaim, yea, jealous wrath creeps on against the Atreides' name. And others far beneath the Ilian wall sleep their last sleep, the goodly chiefs and tall, couched in the foeman's land whereon they gave their breath, and lords of Troy, each in his Trojan grave. End of part one. Recording by Expatriate in Bangor, Maine. Part two of Agamemnon by Aeschylus. Translated by Edmund Doidge Anderson Morshead, 1849-1912. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Expatriate in Bangor, Maine. Part 2. The chorus continues. Therefore for each and all the city's breast is heavy with a wrath suppressed, as deep and deadly as a curse more loud flung by the common crowd. And brooding deeply doth my soul await tidings of coming fate, buried as yet in darkness' womb. For not forgetful is the high god's doom against the sons of carnage. All too long seems the unjust to prosper and be strong, till the dark furies come and smite with stern reversal all his home, down into dim obstruction he is gone, and help and hope among the lost is none. Or him who vaunteth an exceeding fame impends a woe condign, the vengeful bolt upon his eyes doth flame, sped from the hand divine. this bliss be mine, ungrudged of God to feel, to tread no city to the dust, nor see my own life thrust down to a slave's estate beneath another's heel. Behold, throughout the city wide, have the swift feet of rumour hide, roused by the joyful flame. But is the news they scatter sooth? Or haply do they give for truth some cheat which heaven doth frame? A child were he, and all unwise, who let his heart with joy be stirred to see the beacon fires arise, and then, beneath some thwarting word, sicken anon with hope deferred. The edge of woman's insight still good news from true divideth ill. Light rumours leap within the bound that fences female credence round, but lightly born, as lightly dies, the tale that springs of her surmise. Soon shall we know whereof the bale fires tell, the beacons kindled with transmitted flame, whether, as well I deem, their tale is true, or whether like some dream delusive came the welcome blaze, but to befool our soul. For lo, I see a herald from the shore draw hither, shadowed with the olive wreath, and thirsty dust, twin brother of the clay, speaks plain of travel far and truthful news. No dumb surmise, nor tongue of flame and smoke, fitfully kindled from the mountain pyre. But plainlier shall his voice say, all is well, or, but away, forebodings adverse now, and on fair promise fair fulfilment come, and whoso for the state prays otherwise, himself reap harvest of his ill desire. Enter herald. O land of Argos, fatherland of mine, to thee at last, beneath the 10th year's sun, my feet return, the bark of my emprise, though one by one hope's anchors broke away, held by the last, and now ride safely here. Long, long my soul despaired to win in death its longed-for rest within our Argive land. And now all hail, O earth, and hail to thee, new-risen sun, and hail our country's god, high-ruling Zeus, and thou, the Pythian lord, whose arrows smote us once, smite thou no more. Was not thy wrath wreaked full upon our heads, O King Apollo, by Scamander's side? Turn thou, be turned, be saviour, healer now. And hail all gods who rule the street and mart, and Hermes hail, my patron and my pride, herald of heaven and lord of heralds here. And heroes, ye who sped us on our way, to one and all I cry, receive again with grace such Argives as the spear has spared. Ah, home of royalty, beloved halls, and solemn shrines, and gods that front the morn, benign as erst, with sun-flushed aspect greet the king, returning after many days. For as from night flash out the beams of day, so out of darkness dawns a light, a king, on you, on Argos, Agamemnon comes. Then hail and greet him well. Such meed befits him whose right hand hewed down the towers of Troy with the great axe of Zeus who righteth wrong, and smote the plain, smote down to nothingness each altar, every shrine, and far and wide dies from the whole land's face its offspring fair. Such mighty yoke of fate he set on Troy, our lord and monarch, Atreus' elder son, and comes at last with blissful honour home. Highest of all who walk on earth today, not Paris, nor the city's self that paid sin's price with him, can boast, whate'er befall, the guerdon we have won outweighs it all. But at fate's judgment seat the robber stands, condemned of rapine, and his prey is torn forth from his hands, and by his deed is reaped a bloody harvest of his home and land, gone down to death, and for his guilt and lust his father's race pays double in the dust. Chorus. Hail, herald of the Greeks, new come from war. Herald. All hail, not death itself can fright me now. Chorus. Was thine heart wrung with longing for thy land? Herald. So that this joy doth brim mine eyes with tears. Chorus. On you too, then, this sweet distress did fall. Herald. How say'st thou? Make me master of thy word. Chorus. You longed for us who pined for you again. Herald. Craved the land us who craved it love for love? Chorus. yea, till my brooding heart moaned out with pain. Herald, whence thy despair, that mars the army's joy? Chorus, sole cure of wrong is silence, saith the saw. Herald, thy king's afar, couldst thou fear other men? Chorus, death had been sweet, as thou didst say but now. Herald, 'tis true, fate smiles at last. Throughout our toil these many years some chances issued fair, and some, I wot, were checkered with a curse. But who on earth hath won the bliss of heaven through time's whole tenor and unbroken wheel? I could a tale unfold of toiling oars, ill rest, scant landings on a shore rock strewn, all pains, all sorrows for our daily doom, and worse and hatefuller our woes on land. For where we couched, close by the foeman's wall, the river plain was ever dank with dews, dropped from the sky, exuded from the earth, a curse that clung unto our sodden garb, and hair as horrent as a wild beast's fell. Why tell the woes of winter, when the birds lay stark and stiff, so stern was Ida's snow? Or summer's scorch, what time the stirless wave sank to its sleep beneath the noonday sun? Why mourn old woes? Their pain has passed away, and passed away from those who fell all care for evermore to rise and live again. Why sum the count of death and render thanks for life by moaning over fate malign? Farewell, a long farewell to all our woes. To us the remnant of the host of Greece comes weal beyond all counterpoise of woe. Thus boast we rightfully to yonder sun, like him far-fleeted over sea and land. The Argive host prevailed to conquer Troy, and in the temples of the gods of Greece hung up these spoils, a shining sign to time. Let those who learn this legend bless aright the city and its chieftains, and repay the meed of gratitude to Zeus who willed and wrought the deed. So stands the tale fulfilled. Chorus. Thy words o'erbear my doubt, for news of good the ear of age hath ever youth enow. But those within and Clytemnestra's self would fain hear all. Glad thou their ears and mine. Re-enter Clytemnestra. Last night, when first the fiery courier came, in sign that Troy is ta'en and raised to earth, so wild a cry of joy my lips gave out that I was chidden. Hath the beacon watch made sure unto thy soul the sack of Troy? A very woman thou, whose heart leaps light at wandering rumors. And with words like these they showed me how I strayed, misled of hope. Yet on each shrine I set the sacrifice, and in the strain they held for feminine went heralds through the city, to and fro, with voice of loud proclaim announcing joy. And in each fane they lit and quenched with wine the spicy perfumes fading in the flame. All is fulfilled. I spare your longer tale. The king himself anon shall tell me all. Remains to think what honor best may greet my lord, the majesty of Argos' home. What day beams fairer on a woman's eyes than this, whereon she flings the portals wide to hail her lord, heaven shielded home from war? This to my husband, that he tarry not, but turn the city's longing into joy. Yea, let him come. And coming may he find a wife no other than he left her, true and faithful as a watchdog to his home, his foeman's foe in all her duties leal, trusty to keep for 10 long years unmarred the store whereon he set his master seal. Be steel deep dyed before ye look to see ill joy, ill fame from other wight in me. Herald, 'tis fairly said. Thus speaks a noble dame, nor speaks amiss when truth informs the boast. Exit Clytemnestra. Chorus. So has she spoken. Be it yours to learn by clear interpreters her specious word. Turn to me, herald. Tell me if anon the second well-loved lord of Argos comes. Hath Menelaus safely sped with you? Herald. Alas! Brief boon unto my friends it were, to flatter them for truth with falsehoods fair. Chorus. Speak joy, if truth be joy, but truth at worst, too plainly truth and joy are here divorced. Herald. The hero and his bark were rapt away, far from the Grecian fleet. 'Tis truth, I say. Chorus. Whether in all men's sight from Ilion born, or from the fleet by stress of weather torn. Herald. Full on the mark thy shaft of speech doth light, and one short word hath told long woes aright. Chorus. But say, what now of him each comrade saith? What their forebodings of his life or death? Herald. Ask me no more. The truth is known to none, save the earth fostering, all surveying sun. Chorus. Say, by what doom the fleet of Greece was driven? How rose, how sank the storm, the wrath of heaven? Herald. Nay, ill it were to mar with sorrow's tale the day of blissful news. The gods demand thanksgiving sundered from solicitude. If one as herald came with rueful face to say, the curse has fallen, and the host gone down to death, and one wide wound has reached the city's heart, and out of many homes many are cast and consecrate to death, beneath the double scourge that Ares loves, the bloody pair, the fire and sword of doom. If such sore burden weighed upon my tongue, 'twere fit to speak such words as gladden fiends. But, coming as he comes who bringeth news of safe return from toil, and issues fair, to men rejoicing in a weal restored, dare I to dash good words with ill, and say how the gods' anger smote the Greeks in storm? For fire and sea that erst held bitter feud, now swore conspiracy and pledged their faith, wasting the Argives worn with toil and war. Night and great horror of the rising wave came o'er us, and the blasts that blow from Thrace clashed ship with ship, and some with plunging prow through scudding drifts of spray and raving storm vanished, as strays by some ill shepherd driven. And when at length the sun rose bright, we saw the Aegean sea-field flecked with flowers of death, corpses of Grecian men and shattered hulls. For us indeed some god, as well I deem, no human power laid hand upon our helm, snatched us or prayed us from the powers of air, and brought our bark through all unharmed in hull, and saving fortune sat and steered us fair, so that no surge should gulf us deep in brine, nor grind our keel upon a rocky shore. So scaped we death that lurks beneath the sea, but under day's white light, mistrustful all of fortune's smile, we sat and brooded deep, shepherds forlorn of thoughts that wandered wild o'er this new woe. For smitten was our host, and lost as ashes scattered from the pyre. Of whom, if any, draw his life-breath yet, be well assured he deems of us as dead, as we of him no other fate forebode, but heaven save all. If Menelaus live, he will not tarry, but will surely come. Therefore, if anywhere the high sun's ray descries him upon earth, preserved by Zeus, who wills not yet to wipe his race away, hope still there is that homeward he may wend. Enough! Thou hast the truth unto the end. Chorus. Say, from whose lips the presage fell? Who read the future all too well, and named her, in her natal hour, Helen the bride with war for dower? 'Twas one of the invisible, guiding his tongue with prescient power, on fleet and host and citadel, war, sprung from her and death did lower, when from the bride-bed's fine-spun veil she to the zephyr spread her sail. Strong blew the breeze, the surge closed o'er the cloven track of keel and oar. But while she fled there drove along, fast in her wake, a mighty throng, a thirst for blood, a thirst for war, forward in fell pursuit they sprung. Then leapt on Simois' bank ashore, the leafy coppices among, no rangers they of wood and field, but huntsmen of the sword and shield. Heaven's jealousy that works its will, sped thus on Troy its destined ill, well named at once the bride and bane. And loud rang out the bridal strain, but they to whom that song befell did turn anon to tears again. Zeus tarries, but avenges still the husband's wrong, the household stain. He, the hearth's lord, brooks not to see its outraged hospitality. Even now, and in far other tone, Troy chants her dirge of mighty moan, woe upon Paris, woe and hate, who wooed his country's doom for mate. This is the burthen of the groan, wherewith she wails disconsolate the blood so many of her own have poured in vain to fend her fate, Troy, thou hast fed and freed to roam a lion cub within thy home, a suckling creature newly ta'en from mother's teat, still fully fain of nursing care, and oft caressed within the arms, upon the breast, even as an infant has it lain, or fawns and licks by hunger pressed the hand that will assuage its pain. In life's young dawn, a well-loved guest, a fondling for the children's play, a joy unto the old and gray. But waxing time and growth betrays the bloodthirst of the lion race, and, for the house's fostering care, unbidden all it revels there, and bloody recompense repays rent flesh of kine, its talons tear, a mighty beast that slays and slays and mars with blood the household fair, a god-sent pest invincible, a minister of fate and hell. Even so to Ilian city came by stealth a spirit as of windless seas and skies, a gentle phantom form of joy and wealth, with love's soft arrows speeding from its eyes, love's rose whose thorn doth pierce the soul in subtle wise. Ah, well a day, the bitter bridal bed, when the fair mischief lay by Paris' side, what curse on palace and on people sped with her the fury sent on Priam's pride, by angered Zeus, what tears of many a widowed bride. Long, long ago to mortals this was told, how sweet security and blissful state have curses for their children, so men hold, and for the man of all too prosperous fate springs from a bitter seed some woe insatiate. Alone, alone, I deem far otherwise, not bliss nor wealth it is, but impious deed, from which that aftergrowth of ill doth rise. Woe springs from wrong, the plant is like the seed, while right in honor's house doth its own likeness breed. Some past impiety, some gray old crime, breeds the young curse that wantons in our ill, early or late when haps the appointed time, and out of light brings power of darkness still, a master fiend, a foe unseen, invincible, a pride accursed that broods upon the race, and home in which dark Ate holds her sway, sin's child and woes that wears its parent's face, while right in smoky cribs shines clear as day, and decks with weal his life who walks the righteous way. From gilded halls that hands polluted raise, right turns away with proud averted eyes, and of the wealth men stamp amiss with praise, heedless to poorer, holier temples hies, and to fate's goal guides all in its appointed wise. Hail to thee, chief of Atreus' race, returning proud from Troy subdued, how shall I greet thy conquering face, how nor a fulsome praise obtrude, nor stint the meed of gratitude? For mortal men who fall to ill take little heed of open truth, but seek unto its semblance still. The show of weeping and of ruth to the forlorn will all men pay, but of the grief their eyes display naught to the heart doth pierce its way. And with the joyous they beguile their lips into a feigned smile, and force a joy unfelt the while. But he who as a shepherd wise doth know his flock can ne'er misread truth in the falsehood of his eyes, who veils beneath a kindly guise a lukewarm love indeed. And thou, our leader, when of yore thou badest Greece go forth to war for Helen's sake, I dare avow that then I held thee not as now, that to my vision thou didst seem dyed in the hues of disesteem. I held thee for a pilot ill, and reckless of thy proper will, endowing others doomed to die with vain and forced audacity. Now from my heart, ungrudgingly, to those that wrought this word be said, well fall the labor ye have sped. Let time and search, O king, declare what men within thy city's bound were loyal to the kingdom's care, and who were faithless found. Enter Agamemnon in a chariot, accompanied by Cassandra. He speaks without descending. Agamemnon. First, as is meet, a king's all hail be said to Argos and the gods that guard the land, gods who with me availed to speed us home, with me availed to wring from Priam's town the due of justice. In the court of heaven the gods in conclave sat and judged the cause. not from a pleader's tongue, and at the close unanimous into the urn of doom, this sentence gave on Ilion and her men death, and where hope drew nigh to pardon's urn, no hand there was to cast a vote therein. And still the smoke of fallen Ilion rises in sight of all men, and the flame of Ate's hecatomb is living yet, and where the towers in dusty ashes sink, rise the rich fumes of pomp and wealth consumed. For this must all men pay unto the gods, the meed of mindful hearts and gratitude. For by our hands the meshes of revenge closed on the prey, and for one woman's sake Troy trodden by the Argive monster lies. The foal, the shielded band that leapt the wall, what time with autumn sank the Pleiades? Yea, o'er the fencing wall a lion sprang ravening and lapped his fill of blood of kings. Such prelude spoken to the gods in full, to you I turn, and to the hidden thing whereof ye spake but now. And in that thought I am as you, and what ye say, say I. For few are they who have such inborn grace as to look up with love and envy not, when stands another on the height of weal. Deep in his heart, whom jealousy hath seized, her poison lurking doth enhance his load. For now beneath his proper woes he chafes, and sighs withal to see another's weal. I speak not idly, but from knowledge sure there be who vaunt an utter loyalty. That is but as the ghost of friendship dead, a shadow in a glass of faith gone by. One only, he who went reluctant forth across the seas with me, Odysseus, he was loyal unto me with strength and will, a trusty trace-horse bound unto my car. Thus, be he yet beneath the light of day, or dead, as well I fear, I speak his praise. Lastly, whate'er be due to men or gods, with joint debate in public council held, we will decide and warily contrive that all which now is well may so abide. For that which haply needs the healer's art, that will we medicine, discerning well if cautery or knife befit the time. Now, to my palace and the shrines of home, I will pass in and greet you first and fair, ye gods who bade me forth and home again, and long may victory tarry in my train. Enter Clytemnestra, followed by maidens bearing purple robes. Clytemnestra. Old men of Argos, lieges of our realm, shame shall not bid me shrink, lest ye should see the love I bear my lord. Such blushing fear dies at the last from hearts of humankind. From mine own soul and from no alien lips, I know and will reveal the life I bore, reluctant through the lingering livelong years, the while my lord beleaguered Ilion's wall. First, that a wife sat sundered from her lord in widowed solitude was utter woe. And woe to hear how rumors many tongues all boded evil. Woe when he who came and he who followed spake of ill on ill, keening lost, lost, all lost, through hall and bower. Had this my husband met so many wounds as by a thousand channels rumor told, no network e'er was full of holes as he. Had he been slain as oft as tidings came that he was dead, he well might boast him now a second Geryon of triple frame, with triple robe of earth above him laid, for that below no matter, triply dead, dead by one death for every form he bore. And thus distraught by news of wrath and woe, oft for self-slaughter had I slung the noose, but others wrenched it from my neck away. Hence haps it that Orestes, thine and mine, the pledge and symbol of our wedded troth, stands not beside us now as he should stand. Nor marvel thou at this. He dwells with one who guards him loyally. 'Tis Phocis' king, Strophius, who warned me erst, bethink thee, queen, what woes of doubtful issue well may fall. Thy lord in daily jeopardy at Troy, while here a populace uncurbed may cry, down with the council, down, bethink thee too. 'Tis the world's way to set a harder heel on fallen power. For thy child's absence, then, such mine excuse, no wily afterthought. For me, long since, the gushing fount of tears is wept away. No drop is left to shed. Dim are the eyes that ever watch till dawn, weeping the bale fires piled for thy return, night after night unkindled. If I slept, each sound, the tiny humming of a gnat, roused me again, again, from fitful dreams, wherein I felt thee smitten, saw thee slain, thrice for each moment of mine hour of sleep. All this I bore, and now, released from woe, I hail my lord as watchdog of a fold, as saving stay-rope of a storm-tossed ship, as column stout that holds the roof aloft, as only child unto a sire bereaved, as land beheld past hope by crews forlorn, as sunshine fair when tempest's wrath is past, as gushing spring to thirsty wayfarer. So sweet it is to scape the press of pain. With such salute I bid my husband hail, nor heaven be wroth therewith, for long and hard I bore that ire of old. Sweet lord, step forth, step from thy car, I pray. Nay, not on earth, plant the proud foot, O king, that trod down Troy. Women, why tarry ye, whose task it is to spread your monarch's path with tapestry? Swift, swift, with purple strew his passage fair, that justice lead him to a home at last he scarcely looked to see. For what remains, zeal unsubdued by sleep shall nerve my hand to work as right and as the gods command. End of part two, recording by expatriate in Bangor, Maine. Part 3 of Agamemnon by Aeschylus, translated by Edmund Doidge Anderson Morshead, 1849-1912. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by expatriate in Bangor, Maine. Part 3. Agamemnon. Daughter of Leda, watcher o'er my home, thy greeting well befits mine absence long, for late and hardly has it reached its end. Know that the praise which honour bids us crave must come from others' lips, not from our own. See, too, that not in fashion feminine thou make a warrior's pathway delicate. Not unto me, as to some eastern lord, bowing thyself to earth to make homage loud. Strew not this purple that shall make each step an arrogance. Such pomp beseems the gods, not me. A mortal man to set his foot on these rich dyes? I hold such pride in fear, and bid thee honour me as man, not god. Fear not. Such footcloths, and all gods apart, loud from the trump of fame my name is blown. Best gift of heaven it is, in glory's hour, to think thereon with soberness. And thou, bethink thee of the adage, call none blessed, till peaceful death have crowned a life of weal. 'Tis said, I fain would fare unvexed by fear. Clytemnestra. Nay, but unsay it. Thwart not thou my will. Agamemnon. No, I have said, and will not mar my word. Clytemnestra. Was it fear made this meekness to the gods? Agamemnon. If cause be cause, 'tis mine for this resolve. Clytemnestra. What think'st thou in thy place had Priam done? Agamemnon. He surely would have walked on broidered robes. Clytemnestra. Then fear not thou the voice of human blame. Agamemnon. Yet mighty is the murmur of a crowd. Clytemnestra. Shrink not from envy, appanage of bliss. Agamemnon. War is not woman's part, nor war of words. Clytemnestra. Yet happy victors well may yield therein. Agamemnon. Dost crave for triumph in this petty strife? Clytemnestra. Yield, of thy grace permit me to prevail. Agamemnon. Then, if thou wilt, let someone stoop to loose swiftly these sandals, slaves beneath my foot, and stepping thus upon the sea's rich dye, I pray, let none among the gods look down with jealous eye on me. Reluctant all to trample thus and mar a thing of price, wasting the wealth of garments' silver worth. Enough hereof, and for the stranger maid lead her within but gently. God on high looks graciously on him whose triumph's hour has made not pitiless. None willingly wear the slave's yoke, and she, the prize and flower of all we won, comes hither in my train, gift of the army to its chief and lord. Now, since in this my will bows down to thine, I will pass in on purples to my home. Clytemnestra. A sea there is, and who shall stay its springs? And deep within its breast a mighty store, precious as silver of the purple dye, whereby the dipped robe doth its tint renew. Enough of such, O king, within thy halls there lies, a store that cannot fail, but I would have gladly vowed unto the gods, cost of 1,000 garments trodden thus, had once the oracle such gift required, contriving ransom for thy life preserved. For while the stock is firm, the foliage climbs, spreading a shade, what time the dog star glows. And thou, returning to thine hearth and home, art as a genial warmth in winter hours, or as a coolness, when the Lord of Heaven mellows the juice within the bitter grape. Such boons and more doth bring into a home the present footstep of its proper lord. Zeus, Zeus, fulfillment's lord, my vows fulfill, and whatsoe'er it be, work forth thy will. Exeunt all but Cassandra and the chorus. Chorus. Wherefore forever on the wings of fear hovers a vision drear before my boding heart, a strain, unbidden and unwelcome, thrills mine ear, oracular of pain. Not as of old upon my bosom's throne sits confidence to spurn such fears, like dreams we know not to discern. Old, old and grey, long since the time has grown, which saw the linked cables moor the fleet when erst it came to Ilion's sandy shore. And now mine eyes and not another's see their safe return. Yet none the less in me the inner spirit sings a boding song, self-prompted sings the fury strain, and seeks in vain, to hope and to be strong. Ah, to some end of fate, unseen, unguessed, are these wild throbbings of my heart and breast. Yea, of some doom they tell, each pulse a knell. Leaf, leaf I were, that all to unfulfillment's hidden realm might fall. Too far our mortal spirits strive, grasping at utter weal, unsatisfied, till the fell curse that dwelleth hard beside thrust down the sundering wall. Too fair they blow, the gales that waft our bark on fortune's tide. Swiftly we sail, the sooner all to drive upon the hidden rock the reef of woe. Then if the hand of caution warily sling forth into the sea part of the freight, lest all should sink below, from the deep death it saves the bark, even so, doom-laden though it be, once more may rise his household who is timely wise. How oft the famine-stricken field is saved by God's large gift, the new year's yield. But blood of man once spilled, once at his feet shed forth, and darkening the plain, nor chant nor charm can call it back again. So Zeus hath willed. Else had he spared the leech Asclepius, skilled to bring men from the dead, the hand divine did smite himself with death, a warning and a sign. Ah me! If fate ordained of old held not the will of gods constrained, controlled, helpless to usward and apart, swifter than speech my heart had poured its presage out. Now fretting, chafing in the dark of doubt, 'tis hopeless to unfold truth from fear's tangled skein, and yearning to proclaim its thought, my soul is prophecy in flame. Re-enter Clytemnestra. Get thee within thou too, Cassandra, go. For Zeus to thee in gracious mercy grants to share the sprinklings of the lustral bowl beside the altar of his guardianship, slave among many slaves. What? Haughty still? Step from the car. Alcmena's son, 'tis said, was sold perforce and bore the yoke of old. Aye, hard it is, but if such fate befall, 'tis a fair chance to serve within a home of ancient wealth and power. An upstart lord, to whom wealth's harvest came beyond his hope, is as a lion to his slaves, in all exceeding fierce, immoderate in sway. Pass in, thou hearest what our ways will be. Chorus. Clear unto thee, O maid, is her command. But thou, within the toils of fate thou art, if such thy will, I urge thee to obey. Yet I misdoubt thou dost nor hear nor heed. Clytemnestra. I wot, unless like swallows she doth use some strange barbarian tongue from oversea, my words must speak persuasion to her soul. Chorus. Obey. There is no gentler way than this. Step from the car's high seat and follow her. Clytemnestra. Truce to this bootless waiting here without. I will not stay. Beside the central shrine the victims stand, prepared for knife and fire, offerings from hearts beyond all hope made glad. Thou, if thou reckest aught of my command, 'twere well done soon. But if thy sense be shut from these my words, let thy barbarian hand fulfill by gesture the default of speech. Chorus. No native is she, thus to read thy words unaided. Like some wild thing of the wood, new trapped, behold, she shrinks and glares on thee. Clytemnestra. 'Tis madness, and the rule of mind distraught, since she beheld her city sink in fire, and hither comes, nor brooks the bit until in foam and blood her wrath be champed away. See ye to her. Unqueenly 'tis for me, unheeded thus, to cast away my words. Exit Clytemnestra. Chorus. But with me pity sits in anger's place. Poor maiden, come thou from the car. No way there is but this. Take up thy servitude. Cassandra. Woe, woe, alas! Earth, mother earth, and thou, Apollo, Apollo! Chorus. Peace! Shriek not to the bright prophetic god, who will not brook the suppliants of woe. Cassandra. Woe, woe, alas! Earth, mother earth, and thou, Apollo, Apollo! Chorus. Hark! With wild curse she calls anew on him, who stands far off and loathes the voice of wail. Cassandra. Apollo, Apollo, god of all ways, but only death's to me. Once and again, O thou destroyer named, thou hast destroyed me, thou my love of old. Chorus. She grows presageful of her woes to come, slave though she be, instinct with prophecy. Cassandra. Apollo, Apollo, god of all ways, but only death's to me. O thou, Apollo, thou destroyer named, what way hast led me, to what evil home? Chorus. Know'st thou it not? The home of Atreus' race. Take these my words forsooth, and ask no more. Cassandra. Home cursed of God, bear witness unto me, ye visioned woes within. The blood-stained hands of them that smite their kin, the strangling noose, and spattered o'er with human blood the reeking floor. Chorus. How like a sleuth-hound questing on the track, keen-scented unto blood and death she hies. Cassandra. Ah, can the ghostly guidance fail, whereby my prophet soul is onwards led? Look, for their flesh the spectre children wail, their sodden limbs on which their father fed. Chorus. Long since we knew of thy prophetic fame, but for those deeds we seek no prophet's tongue. Cassandra. God, 'tis another crime, worse than the storied woe of olden time. Cureless, abhorred, that one is plotting here, a shaming death for those that should be dear. Alas, and far away in foreign land, he that should help doth stand. Chorus. I knew the old tales, the city rings withal, but now thy speech is dark, beyond my ken. Cassandra. O wretch, O purpose fell, thou for thy wedded lord the cleansing wave hast poured, a treacherous welcome. How the sequel tell? Too soon 'twill come, too soon, for now, even now, she smites him, blow on blow. Chorus. Riddles beyond my rede. I peer in vain through the dim films that screen the prophecy. Cassandra. God! A new sight, a net, a snare of hell set by her hand, herself a snare more fell. A wedded wife, she slays her lord, helped by another hand. Ye powers, whose hate of Atreus' home no blood can satiate, raise the wild cry above the sacrifice abhorred. Chorus. Why biddest thou some fiend, I know not whom, shriek o'er the house? Thine is no cheering word. Back to my heart in frozen fear I feel my waning lifeblood run. The blood that round the wounding steel ebbs slow as sinks life's parting sun, swift, swift and sure, some woe comes pressing on. Cassandra. Away, away, keep him away, the monarch of the herd, the pasture's pride, far from his mate, in treacherous wrath, muffling his swarthy horns with secret scathe, she gores his fenceless side. Hark, in the brimming bath, the heavy plash, the dying cry. Hark, in the laver, hark, he falls by treachery. Chorus. I read amiss dark sayings such as thine, yet something warns me that they tell of ill. O dark prophetic speech, ill tidings dost thou teach ever to mortals here below. Ever some tale of awe and woe through all thy windings manifold do we unriddle and unfold. Cassandra. Ah, well a day, the cup of agony whereof I chant foams with a draught for me. Ah, Lord, ah, leader, thou hast led me here. Was it but to die with thee whose doom is near? Chorus. Distraught thou art, divinely stirred, and wailest for thyself a tuneless lay, as piteous as the ceaseless tale wherewith the brown melodious bird doth ever Itys, Itys wail, deep-bowered in sorrow all its little lifetime's day. Cassandra. Ah, for thy fate, O shrill-voiced nightingale, some solace for thy woes did heaven afford, clothe thee with soft brown plumes, and life apart from wail, but for my death is edged the double-biting sword. Chorus. What pangs are these, what fruitless pains, sent on thee from on high? Thou chantest terror's frantic strain, yet in shrill measured melody. How thus unerring canst thou sweep along the prophet's path of boding song? Cassandra. Woe, Paris, woe on thee! Thy bridal joy was death and fire upon thy race and Troy, and woe for thee, Scamander's flood. Beside thy banks, O river fair, I grew in tender nursing care, from childhood unto maidenhood. Now not by thine, but by Cocytus' stream and Acheron's banks shall ring my boding scream. Chorus. Too plain is all, too plain. A child might read aright thy fateful strain. Deep in my heart their piercing fang terror and sorrow set, the while I heard that piteous low tender word, yet to mine ear and heart a crushing pang. Cassandra. Woe for my city, woe for Ilion's fall! Father, how oft with sanguine stain streamed on thine altar stone the blood of cattle, slain that heaven might guard our wall, but all was shed in vain. Low lie the shattered towers whereas they fell, and I, ah, burning heart, shall soon lie low as well. Chorus. Of sorrow is thy song, of sorrow still. Alas, what power of ill sits heavy on thy heart, and bids thee tell in tears of perfect moan thy deadly tale? Some woe, I know not what, must close thy piteous wail. Cassandra. List, for no more the presage of my soul, bride-like, shall peer from its secluding veil. But as the morning wind blows clear the east, more bright shall blow the wind of prophecy. And as against the low bright line of dawn heaves high and higher yet the rolling wave, so in the clearing skies of prescience dawns on my soul a further deadlier woe. And I will speak, but in dark speech no more. Bear witness ye and follow at my side. I sent the trail of blood shed long ago. Within this house a choir abidingly chants in harsh unison the chant of ill. Yea, and they drink, for more in hardened joy, man's blood for wine, and revel in the halls. Departing never, furies of the home, they sit within. They chant the primal curse, each spitting hatred on that crime of old. The brother's couch, the love incestuous that brought forth hatred to the ravisher. Say, is my speech o'er wild and erring now, or doth its arrow cleave the mark indeed? They called me once the prophetess of lies, the wandering hag, the pest of every door. Attest ye now, she knows in very sooth the house's curse, the storied infamy. Chorus. Yet how should oath, how loyally soe'er I swear it, aught avail thee?
In good sooth, my wonder meets thy claim. I stand amazed that thou, a maiden born beyond the seas, dost as a native know and tell aright tales of a city of an alien tongue.
Cassandra,
that is my power, a boon Apollo gave.
Chorus,
God though he were, yearning for mortal maid?
Cassandra,
aye, what seemed shame of old is shame no more.
Chorus,
such finer sense suits not with slavery.
Cassandra,
he strove to win me, panting for my love.
Chorus,
came ye by compact unto bridal joys?
Cassandra,
nay, for I plighted troth, then foiled the god.
Chorus,
wert thou already dowered with prescience?
Cassandra,
yea, prophetess to joy of all her doom.
Chorus,
how left thee then Apollo's wrath unscathed?
Cassandra,
I, false to him, seen prophet false to all.
Chorus,
not so. To us at least thy words seem sooth.
Cassandra,
woe for me, woe! Again the agony, dread pain that sees the future all too well, with ghastly preludes whirls and racks my soul. Behold ye yonder in the palace roof the spectre children sitting. Look, such things as dreams are made on, phantoms as of babes, horrible shadows that a kinsman's hand hath marked with murder, and their arms are full, a rueful burden, see they hold them up, the entrails upon which their father fed. For this, I say, their plot's revenge, a coward lion couching in the lair, guarding the gate against my master's foot. My master mine, I bear the slave's yoke now. And he, the lord of ships who trod down Troy, knows not the fawning treachery of tongue of this thing false and doglike, how her speech gloses and sleeks her purpose, till she win by ill fate's favor the desired chance, moving like Ate to a secret end. Oh, aweless soul, the woman slays her lord. Woman, what loathsome monster of the earth were fit comparison? The double snake, or Scylla where she dwells, the seaman's bane, girt round about with rocks, some hag of hell, raving a truceless curse upon her kin? Hark, even now she cries exultingly, the vengeful cry that tells of battle turned. How fain, forsooth, to greet her chief restored. Nay, then, believe me not. What skills belief or disbelief? Fate works its will, and thou wilt see and say in ruth her tale was true.
Chorus.
Ah, 'tis Thyestes' feast on kindred flesh. I guess her meaning, and with horror thrill, hearing no shadowed hint of the o'er-true tale, but its full hatefulness. Yet, for the rest, far from the track I roam, and know no more.
Cassandra,
'tis Agamemnon's doom thou shalt behold.
Chorus,
peace, hapless woman, to thy boding words.
Cassandra,
far from my speech stands he who sains and saves.
Chorus,
aye, were such doom at hand, which God forbid.
Cassandra,
thou prayest idly, these move swift to slay.
Chorus,
what man prepares a deed of such despite?
Cassandra,
fool, thus to read amiss mine oracles.
Chorus,
deviser and device are dark to me.
Cassandra,
dark? All too well I speak the Grecian tongue.
Chorus,
aye, but in thine, as in Apollo's strains, familiar is the tongue, but dark the thought.
Cassandra,
ah, the fire, it waxes, nears me now. Woe, woe for me, Apollo of the dawn. Lo, how the woman thing, the lioness, couched with the wolf, her noble mate afar, will slay me, slave forlorn. Yea, like some witch, she drugs the cup of wrath that slays her lord with double death, his recompense for me. Aye, 'tis for me the prey he bore from Troy, that she hath sworn his death and edged the steel. Ye wands, ye wreaths that cling around my neck, ye showed me prophetess, yet scorned of all. I stamp you into death, or ere I die, down to destruction. Thus I stand revenged. Go, crown some other with a prophet's woe. Look, it is he, it is Apollo's self, rending from me the prophet robe he gave. God, while I wore it yet, thou sawst me mocked, there at my home by each malicious mouth, to all and each an undivided scorn, the name alike and fate of witch and cheat. Woe, poverty and famine, all I bore. And at this last the god hath brought me here unto death's toils, and what his love had made, his hate unmakes me now. And I shall stand not now before the altar of my home, but me a slaughterhouse and block of blood shall see hewn down, a reeking sacrifice. Yet shall the gods have heed of me who die, for by their will shall one requite my doom. He to avenge my father's blood outpoured shall smite and slay with matricidal hand. Aye, he shall come, though far away he roam, a banished wanderer in a stranger's land, to crown his kindred's edifice of ill, called home to vengeance by his father's fall. Thus have the high gods sworn and shall fulfill. And now, why mourn I, tarrying on earth, since first mine Ilion has found its fate, and I beheld, and those who won the wall pass to such issue as the gods ordain? I too will pass, and like them dare to die. Turns and looks upon the palace door. Portal of Hades, thus I bid thee hail. Grant me one boon, a swift and mortal stroke, that all unwrung by pain, with ebbing blood shed forth in quiet death, I close mine eyes. Chorus. Maid of mysterious woes, mysterious lore, long was thy prophecy, but if aright thou readest all thy fate, how thus unscared dost thou approach the altar of thy doom, as fronts the knife some victim heaven controlled. Cassandra. Friends, there is no avoidance in delay. Chorus. Yet who delays the longest, his the gain. Cassandra. The day is come, flight were small gain to me. Chorus. O brave endurance of a soul resolved. Cassandra. That were ill praise for those of happier doom. Chorus. All fame is happy, even famous death. Cassandra. Ah, sire, ah, brethren, famous once were ye. She moves to enter the house, then starts back. Chorus. What fear is this that scares thee from the house? Cassandra. Pah! Chorus. What is this cry? Some dark despair of soul? Cassandra. Pah! The house fumes with stench and spilth of blood. Chorus. How? 'Tis the smell of household offerings. Cassandra. 'Tis rank as charnel scent from open graves. Chorus. Thou canst not mean this scented Syrian nard. Cassandra. Nay, let me pass within to cry aloud the monarch's fate and mine. Enough of life. Ah, friends, bear to me witness, since I fall in death, that not as birds that shun the bush and scream, I moan in idle terror. This attests when for my death's revenge another dies, a woman for a woman, and a man falls, for a man ill-wedded to his curse. Grant me this boon, the last before I die. Chorus. Brave to the last, I mourn thy doom foreseen. Cassandra. Once more one utterance, but not of wail, though for my death, and then I speak no more. Son, thou whose beam I shall not see again, to thee I cry. Let those whom vengeance calls to slay their kindred slayers quit withal the death of me, the slave, the fenceless prey. Ah, state of mortal man, in time of weal a line, a shadow, and if ill fate fall, one wet sponge sweep wipes all our trace away, and this I deem less piteous of the twain. Exit into the palace. End of part 3. Recording by expatriate in Bangor, Maine. Part 4 of Agamemnon by Aeschylus, translated by Edmund Doidge Anderson Morshead, 1849-1912. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by expatriate in Bangor, Maine. Part 4. Chorus. Too true it is, our mortal state with blisses never satiate, and none before the palace high and stately of prosperity cries to us with a voice of fear, "Away, 'tis ill to enter here. Lo, this our Lord hath trodden down by grace of heaven old Priam's town, and praised as God he stands once more on Argos' shore. Yet now, if blood shed long ago cries out that other blood shall flow, his life blood, his, to pay again the stern requital of the slain, peace to that braggart's vaunting vein, who, having heard the chieftain's tale, yet boasts of bliss untouched by bale." A loud cry from within. Voice of Agamemnon. "Oh, I am sped, a deep, a mortal blow!" Chorus. "Listen, listen, who is screaming as in mortal agony?" Voice of Agamemnon. "Oh, oh, again, another, another blow!" Chorus. "The bloody act is over. I have heard the monarch's cry. Let us swiftly take some counsel, lest we too be doomed to die." One of the chorus. "'Tis best, I judge, aloud for aid to call. Ho, loyal Argives, to the palace all!" Another. "Better, I deem, ourselves to bear the aid, and drag the deed to light while drips the blade." Another. "Such will is mine, and what thou say'st I say. Swiftly to act, the time brooks no delay." Another. "Aye, for 'tis plain, this prelude of their song foretells its close in tyranny and wrong." Another. "Behold, we tarry, but thy name, delay, they spurn and press with sleepless hand to slay." Another. "I know not what 'twere well to counsel now. Who wills to act, 'tis his to counsel how." Another. "Thy doubt is mine, for when a man is slain, I have no words to bring his life again." Another. "What, e'en for life's sake, bow us to obey these house defilers and their tyrant's sway?" Another. "Unmanly doom! 'Twere better far to die. Death is a gentler lord than tyranny." Another. "Think well. Must cry or sign of woe or pain fix our conclusion that the chief is slain?" Another. "Such talk befits us when the deed we see. Conjecture dwells afar from certainty." Leader of the Chorus. "I read one will from many a diverse word, to know aright how stands it with our lord." The scene opens, disclosing Clytemnestra, who comes forward. The body of Agamemnon lies, muffled in a long robe, within a silver-sided laver. The corpse of Cassandra is laid beside him. Clytemnestra. "Ho, ye who heard me speak so long and oft, the glozing word that led me to my will, hear how I shrink not to unsay it all. How else should one who willeth to requite evil for evil to an enemy, disguised as friend, weave the mesh straightly round him, not to be overleaped, a net of doom? This is the sum and issue of old strife, of me deep pondered and at length fulfilled. All is avowed, and as I smote I stand with foot set firm upon a finished thing. I turn not to denial. Thus I wrought, so that he could nor flee nor ward his doom. Even as the trammel hems the scaly shoal, I trapped him with inextricable toils, the ill abundance of a baffling robe, then smote him once again, and at each wound he cried aloud, then as in death relaxed each limb and sank to earth. And as he lay, once more I smote him with the last third blow, sacred to Hades, savior of the dead. And thus he fell, and as he passed away, spirit with body chafed, each dying breath flung from his breast swift bubbling jets of gore, and the dark sprinklings of the rain of blood fell upon me, and I was fain to feel that dew, not sweeter is the rain of heaven to cornland when the green sheath teems with grain. Elders of Argos, since the thing stands so, I bid you to rejoice, if such your will. Rejoice or not, I vaunt and praise the deed, and well I ween, if seemly it could be, 'twere not ill done to pour libations here, justly, aye, more than justly, on his corpse, who filled his home with curses as with wine, and thus returned to drain the cup he filled. Chorus. I marvel at thy tongue's audacity, to vaunt thus loudly o'er a husband slain. Clytemnestra. Ye hold me as a woman weak of will, and strive to sway me, but my heart is stout, nor fears to speak its uttermost to you, albeit ye know its message. Praise or blame, even as ye list, I reck not of your words. Lo, at my feet lies Agamemnon slain, my husband once, and him this hand of mine, a right contriver, fashioned for his death. Behold the deed. Chorus. Woman, what deadly birth, what venomed essence of the earth, or dark distillment of the wave, to thee such passion gave, nerving thine hand to set upon thy brow this burning crown, the curses of thy land? Our king by thee cut off, hewn down, go forth, they cry, accursed and forlorn, to hate and scorn. Clytemnestra. O ye just men, who speak my sentence now, the city's hate, the ban of all my realm, ye had no voice of old to launch such doom on him, my husband, when he held as light my daughter's life as that of sheep or goat, one victim from the thronging fleecy fold, yea, slew in sacrifice his child and mine, the well-loved issue of my travail pangs, to lull and lay the gales that blew from Thrace. That deed of his, I say, that stain and shame, had rightly been atoned by banishment. But ye, who then were dumb, are stern to judge this deed of mine that doth affront your ears. Storm out your threats, yet knowing this forsooth, that I am ready, if your hand prevail as mine now doth, to bow beneath your sway. If God say nay, it shall be yours to learn by chastisement a late humility. Chorus. Bold is thy craft, and proud thy confidence, thy vaunting loud. Thy soul that chose a murderous fate is all with blood elate, maddened to know the blood not yet avenged, the damned spot crimson upon thy brow. But fate prepares for thee thy lot, smitten as thou didst smite, without a friend to meet thine end. Clytemnestra, hear then the sanction of the oath I swear. By the great vengeance for my murdered child, by Ate, by the fury unto whom this man lies sacrificed, by hand of mine, I do not look to tread the hall of fear, while in this hearth and home of mine there burns the light of love, Aegisthus, as of old loyal, a stalwart shield of confidence, as true to me as this slain man was false, wronging his wife with paramours at Troy, fresh from the kiss of each Chryseis there. Behold him dead, behold his captive prize, seeress and harlot, comfort of his bed, true prophetess, true paramour. I wot the sea-bench was not closer to the flesh, full oft of every rower, than was she. See, ill they did, and ill requites them now. His death ye know. She, as a dying swan, sang her last dirge, and lies as erst she lay, close to his side, and to my couch has left a sweet new taste of joys that know no fear. Chorus. Ah, woe and well-a-day! I would that fate, not bearing agony too great, nor stretching me too long on couch of pain, would bid mine eyelids keep the morningless and unawakening sleep. For life is weary now my lord is slain, the gracious among kings. Hard fate of old he bore, and many grievous things, and for a woman's sake on Ilian land, now is his life hewn down, and by a woman's hand. O Helen, O infatuate soul, who bad'st the tides of battle roll, o'erwhelming thousands, life on life, neath Ilian's wall, and now lies dead the lord of all. The blossom of thy storied sin bears blood's inexpiable stain. O thou that erst these halls within wert unto all a rock of strife, a husband's bane. Clytemnestra, peace. Pray not thou for death, as though thine heart was whelmed beneath this woe, nor turn thy wrath aside to ban the name of Helen, nor recall how she, one bane of many a man, sent down to death the Danaan lords, to sleep at Troy the sleep of swords, and wrought the woe that shattered all. Chorus. Fiend of the race, that swoopest fell upon the double stock of Tantalus, lording it o'er me by a woman's will, stern, manful, and imperious, a bitter sway to me, thy very form I see, like some grim raven perched upon the slain, exulting o'er the crime aloud in tuneless strain.
Clytemnestra, right was that word. Thou namest well the brooding race-fiend, triply fell. From him it is that murder's thirst, blood-lapping, inwardly is nursed, ere time the ancient scar can sane, new blood comes welling forth again.
Chorus.
Grim is his wrath, and heavy on our home, that fiend of whom thy voice has cried. Alas, an omened cry of woe unsatisfied, an all-devouring doom. Ah, woe! Ah, Zeus! From Zeus all things befall. Zeus, the high cause and finisher of all. Lord of our mortal state, by him are willed all things, by him fulfilled. Yet, ah, my king, no more. What words to say, what tears to pour, can tell my love for thee? The spider web of treachery she wove and wound thy life around, and lo, I see thee lie, and through a coward, impious wound pant forth thy life and die. A death of shame, ah, woe on woe, a treacherous hand, a cleaving blow.
Clytemnestra,
my guilt thou harpest o'er and o'er. I bid thee reckon me no more as Agamemnon's spouse, the old avenger stern of mood, for Atreus in his feast of blood hath struck the lord of Atreus' house, and in the semblance of his wife the king hath slain, yea, for the murdered children's life a chieftain's in requital ta'en.
Chorus.
Thou guiltless of this murder, thou? Who dares such thought avow? Yet it may be, wroth for the parent's deed, the fiend hath holpen thee to slay the son. Dark Ares, god of death, is pressing on through streams of blood by kindred shed, exacting thee a compt for children dead, for clotted blood, for flesh on which their sire did feed. Yet, ah, my king, no more. What words to say, what tears to pour, can tell my love for thee? The spider web of treachery she wove and wound thy life around, and lo, I see thee lie, and through a coward, impious wound pant forth thy life and die. A death of shame, ah, woe on woe, a treacherous hand, a cleaving blow.
Clytemnestra,
I deem not that the death he died had overmuch of shame, for this was he who did provide foul wrong unto his house and name. His daughter, blossom of my womb, he gave unto a deadly doom, Iphigenia, child of tears, and as he wrought, even so he fares. Nor be his vaunt too loud in hell, for by the sword his sin he wrought, and by the sword himself is brought among the dead to dwell.
Chorus.
Ah, whither shall I fly? For all in ruin sinks the kingly hall. Nor swift device nor shift of thought have I to scape its fall. A little while the gentler raindrops fail. I stand distraught a ghastly interval, till on the roof-tree rings the bursting hail of blood and doom. Even now fate whets the steel on whetstones new and deadlier than of old, the steel that smites injustice hold another death to deal. O earth, that I had lain at rest and lapped forever at thy breast, ere I had seen my chieftain fall within the laver's silver wall, low lying on dishonored bier, and who shall give him sepulchre, and who the wail of sorrow pour? Woman, 'tis thine no more, a graceless gift unto his shade, such tribute by his murderous paid. Strive not thus wrongly to atone the impious deed thy hand hath done. Ah, who above the godlike chief shall weep the tears of loyal grief? Who speak above his lowly grave the last sad praises of the brave?
Clytemnestra,
peace, for such task is none of thine. By me he fell, by me he died, and now his burial rites be mine. Yet from these halls no mourner's train shall celebrate his obsequies. Only by Acheron's rolling tide his child shall spring unto his side, and in a daughter's loving wise shall clasp and kiss him once again.
Chorus.
Lo, sin by sin, and sorrow dog by sorrow, and who the end can know? The slayer of today shall die tomorrow, the wage of wrong is woe. While time shall be, while Zeus in heaven is lord, his law is fixed and stern. On him that wrought shall vengeance be outpoured. The tides of doom return,
The children of the curse abide within these halls of high estate, and none can wrench from off the home of sin the clinging grasp of fate.
Clytemnestra. Now walks thy word aright to tell this ancient truth of oracle, but I with vows of sooth will pray to him, the power that holdeth sway o'er all the race of Pleisthenes, though dark the deed and deep the guilt, with this last blood my hands have spilt, I pray thee let thine anger cease. I pray thee pass from us away to some new race in other lands, there if thou wilt to wrong and slay the lives of men by kindred hands. For me 'tis all sufficient meed, though little wealth or power were won, so I can say 'tis past and done. The bloody lust and murderous, the inborn frenzy of our house is ended by my deed.
Enter Aegisthus.
Aegisthus, dawn of the day of rightful vengeance hail, I dare at length aver that gods above have care of men and heed of earthly wrongs. I who stand and thus exult to see this man lie wound in robes the Furies wove, slain in requital of his father's craft. Take ye the truth, that Atreus, this man's sire, the lord and monarch of this land of old, held with my sire Thyestes deep dispute, brother with brother, for the prize of sway, and drave him from his home to banishment. Thereafter the lorn exile homeward stole, and clung a suppliant to the hearth divine, and for himself won this immunity, not with his own blood to defile the land that gave him birth, but Atreus' godless sire of him who here lies dead, this welcome planned. With zeal that was not love, he feigned to hold in loyal joy a day of festal cheer, and bade my father to his board, and set before him flesh that was his children once. First, sitting at the upper board alone, he hid the fingers and the feet, but gave the rest, and readily Thyestes took what to his ignorance no semblance wore of human flesh and ate. Behold, what curse that eating brought upon our race and name! For when he knew what all unhallowed thing he thus had wrought, with horror's bitter cry back starting, spewing forth the fragments foul, on Pelops' house a deadly curse he spake, as darkly as I spurn this damned food, so perish all the race of Pleisthenes. Thus by that curse fell he whom here ye see, and I, who else, this murder wove and planned. For me an infant yet in swaddling bands of the three children youngest, Atreus sent to banishment by my sad father's side. But justice brought me home once more, grown now to manhood's years. And stranger though I was, my right hand reached unto the chieftain's life, plotting and planning all that malice bade. And death itself were honour now to me, beholding him in justice ambush ta'en.
Chorus. Aegisthus, for this insolence of thine that vaunts itself in evil, take my scorn. Of thine own will, thou sayest, thou hast slain the chieftain, by thine own unaided plot devised the piteous death. I rede thee well. Think not thy head shall scape when right prevails, the people's ban, the stones of death and doom.
Aegisthus. This word from thee? This word from one who rows low at the oars beneath, what time we rule, we of the upper tier? Thou'lt know anon. 'Tis better to be taught again in age by one so young, submission at the word. But iron of the chain and hunger's throes can minister unto an o'er-swoln pride. Marvellous well, aye, even in the old. Hast eyes and seest not this? Peace! Kick not thus against the pricks unto thy proper pain.
Chorus. Thou womanish man, waiting till war did cease, home-watcher and defiler of the couch, and arch-deviser of the chieftain's doom.
Aegisthus. Bold words again, but they shall end in tears, the very converse thine of Orpheus' tongue. He roused and led in ecstasy of joy all things that heard his voice melodious. But thou, as with the futile cry of curs, will draw men wrathfully upon thee. Peace! Or strong subjection soon shall tame thy tongue.
Chorus. Aye, thou art one to hold an Argive down, thou skilled to plan the murder of the king, but not with thine own hand to smite the blow.
Aegisthus, that fraudful force was woman's very part, not mine,
whom deep suspicion from of old would have debarred. Now by his treasure's aid my purpose holds to rule the citizens. But whoso will not bear my guiding hand, him for his corn-fed mettle I will drive, not as a trace-horse, light caparisoned, but to the shafts with heaviest harness bound. Famine, the grim mate of the dungeon dark, shall look on him and shall behold him tame. Chorus. Thou losel soul, was then thy strength too slight to deal in murder, while a woman's hand staining and shaming Argos and its gods availed to slay him? No, if anywhere the light of life smite on Orestes' eyes, let him, returning by some guardian fate, hew down with force her paramour and her. Aegisthus. How thy word and act shall issue, thou shalt shortly understand. Chorus. Up to action, O my comrades, for the fight is hard at hand. Swift, your right hands to the sword hilt, bear the weapon as for strife. Aegisthus. Lo, I too am standing ready, hand on hilt for death or life. Chorus. 'Twas thy word, and we accept it. Onward to the chance of war. Clytemnestra. Nay, enough, enough, my champion. We will smite and slay no more. Already have we reaped enough the harvest field of guilt, enough of wrong and murder. Let no other blood be spilt. Peace, old men, and pass away unto the homes by fate decreed, lest ill valor meet our vengeance. 'Twas a necessary deed. But enough of toils and troubles. Be the end, if ever, now. Ere thy talon, O avenger, deal another deadly blow. 'Tis a woman's word of warning, and let who will list thereto. Aegisthus. But that these should loose and lavish reckless blossoms of the tongue, and in hazard of their fortune cast upon me words of wrong, and forget the law of subjects, and revile their ruler's word? Chorus. Ruler? But 'tis not for Argives thus to own a dastard lord. Aegisthus. I will follow to chastise thee in my coming days of sway. Chorus. Not if fortune guide Orestes safely on his homeward way. Aegisthus. Ah, well I know how exiles feed on hopes of their return. Chorus. Fair and batten on pollution of the right while 'tis thy turn. Aegisthus. Thou shalt pay, be well assured, heavy quittance for thy pride. Chorus. Crow and strut, with her to watch thee, like a cock his mate beside. Clytemnestra. Heed not thou too highly of them. Let the cur-pack growl and yell. I and thou will rule the palace, and will order all things well. Exeunt. End of part 4. Recording by expatriate in Bangor, Maine. End of Agamemnon by Aeschylus. Translated by Edmund Doidge Anderson Morshead, 1849 to 1912.